Good morning, church. It's the Lord's Day, and we're here to worship today. And I'm here to share with you from God's Word about what it means to be the church. Let's open with a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, thank you. Thank you for this day. This is the day you have made, and we will rejoice and be glad in it. Thank you for your watch care over these past couple months. Father, thank you for the fact that so far as I know, that none of this church family has contracted the coronavirus. Father, I pray a hedge of protection around this flock. And Father, I just pray you continue to watch over us. We trust that you have a great and glorious sovereign plan for our nation, for our church, and for this world. And Father, we pray. Lord, we pray that you would be glorified, that your name would be magnified, that your name would be hallowed in all the earth. Father, be with us this morning as we continue to look at what it means to be the church, as we look at how the early church was structured and how they served one another and made sure people didn't fall through the cracks. Father, I pray for our church family, for those who may be hearing this message or watching this message, and feeling like somehow they have fallen through the cracks. Father, I want them to know that we care. And Father, it's just a challenge to know how to get a hold of people. And so, Father, I pray that every person who would hear this would know beyond the shadow of a doubt they're loved and they're cared for, certainly by you, but also by this church. And Father, I pray that we would come together in such a way to minister to one another that no one would fall through the cracks. Father, I love you. Open our minds to understand your word and to hear what your spirit would say to us today. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Man, I'm excited to be with you again. I look forward to hopefully soon actually getting to see you face to face and worshiping here in our facility again. But I pray that you will worship today, that you will spend time in prayer and praise and learning and reading and listening to God's word, that you might continue to grow in your faith. Take your Bibles and turn with me to Acts chapter 6 as we continue to look at what does it mean to be the church and looking particularly at the early church as our model. And so the first thing I would have to say here is this is a passage that is most often referred to when it comes time to talk about deacons. Well, the word diakonos, from which we get deacon, literally means servant. And folks, the truth of the matter is we're all called to serve one another. We're all called to be a deacon, one who serves. Now, it wasn't until about maybe as much as 200 years ago you began to see the development of a deacon board, where deacons began to run the church. But that was not the model in the New Testament. And folks, I'm not sure it's the best model for the way a church ought to be run. It started during the Industrial Revolution, when these men who served on boards at their businesses came to realize how well that helped a business function. And so they began to form a board of deacons who then began to run the church. Well, that's not how God intended it. That's not the function of a deacon. A deacon is to serve. And so today's sermon I've entitled Serving Everyone and Everyone Serving. Let's read together from Acts chapter 6. Now at this time, while the disciples were increasing in number, a complaint arose on the part of the Hellenistic Jews, that is, the Greek-speaking Jews, against the native Hebrews, because their widows were being overlooked in the daily serving of food. So the 12 summoned the congregation of the disciples and said, "It is not desirable for us to neglect the word of God in order to serve tables. Therefore, brethren, select from among you 7 men of good reputation, full of the Spirit and of wisdom, who we may put in charge of this task. But we will devote ourselves to prayer and to the ministry of the word." The statement found approval with the whole congregation, and they chose Stephen, a man full of faith, and of the Holy Spirit, and Philip, and Prochorus, Nicanor, Timon, Parmenius, and Nicholas, a proselyte from Antioch. And these they brought before the apostles, and after praying, they laid their hands on them. The word of God kept on spreading, and the number of disciples continued to increase greatly in Jerusalem. And a great many of the priests were becoming obedient to the faith. Folks, as we unpack this passage here, the first thing I want us to see is that the church in Jerusalem was a rapidly growing church. If you go back and you look in the book of Acts, Acts chapter 2, verse 41 says that on the day of Pentecost, when Peter preached a sermon, about 3,000 souls were added to the church that day. By Acts chapter 4, verse 4, it says the number of the men came to be about 5,000. And then in Acts 5:1, which we looked at, 5:14, which we looked at last week, it said multitudes of men and women were added daily to the church. And now here we see in Acts chapter 6, verse 1, the disciples were increasing in number. This was a growing church. This was a church that was attracting more and more people. Well, here's the truth of the matter is, there are common challenges in churches, especially churches that are growing. And I want to name three of them here that every church leadership team will have to deal with as a church grows. The first is complaints. We see this here in verse 1, that the Hellenistic Jews, the Greek-speaking Jews, their widows were being left out when food was being served to the widows. That the widows came under the care of the church, and one of the responsibilities was to make sure they had adequate food. Well, some of the women were being left out. Some of the women weren't getting their share. And so a complaint arose. Folks, can I tell you something? The church is divinely created, but it's made up of sinful humans. And the truth of the matter is, we're always going to make mistakes. Things are going to go wrong. People aren't going to like certain decisions that are made. And one of the first responses of human beings is we begin to complain. We don't like the circumstances. We don't like the way things are working out. And we begin to complain. Paul writes and says, do all things without complaint, without grumbling. And so it is here that there was probably a better way to handle this, but as it started out, there was a complaint. People were falling through the cracks. The second thing we see here as a problem in many churches is divisions, cliques, power groups, one group pitted against another. It was the Greek-speaking Jews versus the Hebrew Jews. It was these two parties, rather than seeing themselves as one body, kind of had this contest, this challenge, this competition between each other. It was an us versus them. We're not getting what they're getting. They're getting something we're not. And so it began to express itself in division. Folks, nearly in every church, you're going to have folks who are complaining. But then there's also groups within a church who begin to divide the fellowship, that feel like somehow they're not getting their share. They're not getting the attention they believe they deserve. And one group begins to criticize the other group. And what happens is the unity of the church begins to crumble. Time and time again in the New Testament, it talks about be of one mind, be of one heart, be of one purpose. That the church needs to be united to be truly effective. And the problem is the divisions begin to arise when we think we're more important or we're being neglected versus the unity we can have in Christ. And so it is, that's what was happening there. And divisions began to arise. And then the last complaint, or the last challenge in a church, you have complaints, you have divisions. But then here's one of the sincere things that really can be a problem. And that is, in any church, you're going to have gaps in ministry. That is, you're going to have occasions where people fall through the cracks, where the attention they need and they deserve and rightly should be entitled to doesn't happen. That somebody gets left out, somebody gets forgotten, somebody gets missed, and there's ministry gaps. Here are three common challenges in churches in this day, in the early church, and still are challenges today. So let's look at how the leaders, the apostles of this day, of this church in Jerusalem, how they began and how they solved and handled the crisis. The first thing we see is that in the early church, it was the apostles who were the leaders of the church. They were chosen by Jesus, and there was only 12 of them. Then after Judas hung himself, it was down to 11, and they replaced him with Matthias, and so that they could be back to the number of 12. But they had apostles, and I'm not so sure. Paul talks about he is an apostle as one untimely born, but I have difficulty wrapping my mind around the idea that one of the characteristics of an apostle was that they were a living witness to the physical resurrected Christ. So I'm a little uncomfortable with the office of an apostle today. But God still provides for his church. In the modern church and in Paul's writings, we see the terms overseers, pastors, elders. In Acts 20:21, he talks about that the elders are chosen by the Spirit to serve over the flock. And so here it is when it comes to church leadership. I'm going to use the terms overseers, pastors, elders interchangeably as what the apostles were doing here. And let's look what the apostles did. The first thing they did was they established the priority of their ministry. It says, so the 12, that is the apostles, summoned the congregation of disciples and said, it is not desirable for us to neglect the word of God in order to serve tables. It wasn't that they were saying serving the widows was unimportant, but they were saying this is not what God called us to do. We have a priority of doing what God has called us to do. In fact, they go on and they say, we want you to select others to handle this. But look at verse 4. We will devote ourselves to prayer and to the ministry of the word. Pastors, overseers, elders, as apostles did in the early church, their primary responsibility is to give themselves to prayer and the ministry of the word. Please understand, that doesn't mean they neglect people. It doesn't mean they don't care about people. But their focus, their laser focus, is on prayer and the ministry of the word. So they began to establish priorities. Their priority was the ministry of the word and prayer. But then these wise apostles, these leaders, these overseers of the church, recommended a solution. They said, select from among you 7 men of good reputation, full of the Spirit and of wisdom, who we may put in charge of this task. What they were talking about was delegating other ministries to reputable and responsible servants. Delegating ministries to reputable and responsible servants. It wasn't that the ministry could just be neglected. It needed to be done. But their focus was on something else. It was on the word and prayer. And what they did is say, choose some other men, and we'll put them in charge of this task. And so it was that they recommended that as a solution. And then they sought the approval of the congregation. In verse 2, they summoned the congregation of disciples and gave them that possibility. Look at verse 5. The statement found approval with the whole congregation. And they chose Stephen, and it goes on and lists the others that they chose. But the thing to understand here is that the apostles didn't just dictate what was to happen any more than overseers, pastors, and elders should dictate what the church should do. They provide solutions. They provide leadership. They provide counsel. They care about the word and prayer and carry out that ministry, but the other ministries, they work with the congregation to make sure the needs are met. And so they sought congregational approval. And servants were selected. And I say servants, we would normally call that deacons there. This is the passage we use to defend the role of deacons. But again, the word deacon means servant. And so the church chose seven reputable and responsible men to be servants to the church to make sure this ministry of feeding was taken care of, that no one would fall through the cracks. And then look at verse 6. And these they brought before the apostles, the seven servants, and they brought them before the apostles, and after praying, they laid their hands on them. They set them apart. They said, these are the guys that we're going to put in charge of this ministry. The congregation selected them, the leadership approved them, and those men began to have the responsibility for that ministry. You see, church leadership does those four things. It establishes priorities. It recommends solutions to problems. It seeks congregational approval. And then the leaders, overseers, pastors, and elders implement and delegate those responsibilities to responsible and reputable ministry servants. So what was the result of this delegating ministry? Look at verse 7. And it says, the word of God kept on spreading, and the number of the disciples continued to increase greatly. Now I want you to understand, day one, 3,000. This Peter's second sermon, you're up to 5,000 men. Then you get to Acts chapter 5. We can't even count them. It just says multitudes of men and women were added to the church daily. And now you see, so how many do we have at this point? You're probably pushing at least close to 8 to 10,000 people. And now it says, and the word of God kept spreading, and the number of disciples continue to increase greatly. It was taking over Jerusalem. There was a movement of God birthing his church. The result of the delegating ministry is first, that the word of God kept spreading. Secondly, the number of disciples continued to increase greatly. And then thirdly, it says, and a great many of the priests were becoming obedient to the faith. That it was having an influence in the world. It was having an influence even in the temple, where priests were being so impacted by the teaching of the church, by the teaching of the apostles, that many priests were coming to believe that Jesus was the Messiah and that salvation was in him alone. So where does that leave us today? Being the church today, God establishes and the New Testament teaches that there are pastor, shepherd, elders, church leaders who are given the responsibility to be devoted to the ministry of prayer, devoted to the ministry of the word and the teaching of the word, and chosen to provide oversight to the church. Time and time again, Paul writes in his letters about the position of an overseer to give oversight to the church. In Acts chapter 20, I referred to it earlier. Let me get to it here. Paul, talking to the elders at Ephesus, says this, be on guard. This is chapter 20, verse 28. I think I said 21 before, 28. Be on guard for yourselves and for all the flock, among which the Holy Spirit has made you overseers, to shepherd the church of God, which he purchased with his own blood. This is the job description, the marching order for elders, pastors, shepherds, overseers. They're devoted to the ministry of prayer, devoted to the ministry of the word, and chosen by the Spirit to have oversight of the work of the church. But then the second role we see here is the role of the deacon. And I want to be careful, because as soon as we think of deacon, we run to 1 Timothy and see the functions of a deacon, and all of a sudden we begin to think of it as an office, when it really should be an understanding as a servant. Being the church today, you have the overseers, elders, pastors, shepherds, and then you have the servants, the delegated servants. You may want to call them deacons. That's a great word. It comes, it's a New Testament word, but it means servant, particularly a delegated servant. And here's what their job was. They were to be put in charge of other ministries. And particularly, this is where our deacons serve so well at River Hills, particularly entrusted to make sure no one falls through the cracks. I got to tell you, Ben and I can't keep up possibly with all the members of the church. And we have a group of men who have been studying for over 2 years now to be presented to the church at some point for the office of elder or overseer or shepherd. But even our numbers can't possibly keep up with everyone. And what's exciting for me is that we have some great deacons, some men who say, I want to be a part of making sure no one falls through the cracks. Now, on our list, we have homebound and widows and widowers, but we make an effort to make sure people who would possibly fall through the cracks are still contacted. Let me say this. If you're needing a contact, if you, and I don't care if you're a widow or a widower or a young family, but you're feeling left out, you're feeling disconnected, I beg you, I ask you, call me. Send me an email. Get in touch with me. Give me a text. We want to make sure no one falls through the cracks. Our deacons are doing a pretty good job at that. They're trying to contact folks. They're checking up on our widows and widowers and single moms and others who we have on our list, our homebound. But folks, I got to tell you, we want to be the church. We want to be the kind of New Testament church where no one falls through the cracks. But we need your help. If you feel disconnected, if you feel like you're falling through the cracks, that no one cares about you, I want to tell you right out loud right now, that is not true. I care. I love you. There's people here at this church who care about you. We may not be real well connected. We might not be close friends, but we care about you. I love you. And I don't want anyone in this time to feel like they're unimportant, like they are falling through the cracks. I beg you, call me. Here's my number, 864-205-1648. 864-205-1648. Call me, text me, let me know. I want to have a chance to talk to you. I want to reach out to you. Or you can send me an email. I've got several emails. Here's one of the emails you can use. Kent@myrhbc.com. Kent@myrhbc.com. Send me an email. Let me know that you need somebody to minister to you. I just want to have the opportunity to pray with you. Can I ask you something else? You pray for me. I don't want anyone falling through the cracks. We want to be praying for one another. We want to be serving one another. If you have a need, let us know. Don't begin by complaining. Don't create divisions. And don't allow anyone to fall through the cracks. That's what we're trying to make sure doesn't happen. This is how the new church operated. The delegated servants, the deacons, were put in charge of other ministries and particularly entrusted to make sure that no one falls through the cracks. And here's the end result. Folks, listen. Everybody is somebody in God's body. Everybody is somebody in God's body. There is no unimportant person in the church. We are all parts of one body, fitted together by the Spirit of God. You're an important part of the body. You know, sometimes you don't think of parts of your body being that important. I don't think about my pinky toe very often. But when I walk through the house at night and the lights are off and I misjudge that door frame and I slam that pinky toe into the door frame, suddenly that pinky toe is the most important part of my body. Folks, you may not feel like you're all that important. You might feel like you don't matter. Can I tell you something? You do. Every part of the body matters. I love you. Listen, Ephesians 4:16 says this, the whole body, that includes you, being fitted and held together by what every joint supplies. Are you supplying what brings the body together? The whole body being fitted and held together by what every joint supplies, according to the proper working of each individual part. That's your responsibility. Each individual part working and held together by what you supply causes the growth of the body for the building up of itself in love. Let me read that again straight through. Listen to the words every and each and your part. The whole body being fitted and held together by what every joint supplies according to the proper working of each individual part causes the growth of the body for the building up of itself in love. Paul writes this to the church at Ephesus. And he's saying, you've got a part to play. Don't be the one who's complaining. Don't be the one who's creating division. Instead, be a part of the body. Provide your part, held together by what every joint supplies according to the proper working of each individual part. Here's what I'm asking you to do. Here's what I want you to understand is your part today. The very first Sunday we were apart from one another, I encouraged you, call a couple people a day. Text somebody. Let somebody know that you care. I want you to renew your commitment to contact people, to make sure no one is falling through the cracks. And if you're sitting out there this morning or whenever you watch this video, if you feel that you're falling through the cracks, call me. I love you. I want to talk with you. I want to find out how you're doing. I want to pray with you. I've been praying for you. I pray for our church. To the best of my ability, I think of the names of everyone I can think of. And I've contacted many. And if I've missed you, I'm sorry. Maybe it's because the number I have is no longer the correct number. But I've given you mine. Call me. Let me minister to you. Let me pray for you. Let me hear from you to find out how you're doing. Call a deacon. Let those guys know. If you have a deacon, if you're a widow, a homebound, a senior adult who's homebound, call your deacon and say, hey, would you pray for me? Would you pray for me? Can I tell you something? We've decided that asking people to pray for us is a sign of weakness. Paul, one of the strongest men of faith in the New Testament, wrote a third of the New Testament. Time and again in his letters to the churches said, pray for me. Pray for me. And if Paul can humble himself enough to ask people to pray for him, I encourage you, pick up the phone. Get out your phone, send a text message, say, I need your prayers. Please pray for me. I want to be inundated. I want to be flooded with texts and calls from my church that says, pray for me. I want to hear from you. This week, I want to hear from you because I don't want anyone to fall through the cracks. The early church had a challenge. Some people were feeling left out. Some people were feeling less important. Folks, there was a model established to make sure that people didn't fall through the cracks. In this time, we need to do a better job because everybody is somebody in God's body. You and I need to make sure we are reaching out to every single person we know in this church and saying, I love you, I care about you, and I'm praying for you. Let me pray for us this morning. Heavenly Father, I thank you that you created the position of a deacon. But Father, we have so given that a title and forgotten what it's about. That the word deacon simply means a servant. And the job of those servants was to make sure nobody fell through the cracks. Father, you know my heart. How desperately I want to make sure no one is falling through the cracks. Father, I pray that we would each take a level of personal responsibility to reach out to one another and to make sure that as one body, all the parts are important. One body fitted together in unity by your Spirit, caring for one another. Father, I once heard a pastor say that the test of the functioning of a body is when one part of the body hurts, how quickly the rest of the body feels it. Father, I pray that we would renew our connections, that we would come together in a spirit of unity, reaching out to one another, praying for one another, rejoicing with one another, and caring for one another. Father, I thank you for the deacons who serve. But I also thank you for the many other ministry leaders we have in our church. For the CR folks, for the Sunday school folks, for the children's ministry, the youth ministry, the men's ministry, the women's ministry, the Lord's Supper committee, the baptismal committee. Father, all these are servants, deacons, who are ministering to the family, ministering to the body. Father, I don't want one to fall through the cracks. Lord, I pray this message would go out with power, not of my preaching or my word, but with the vision of what can be done when we are united as one body, caring for one another and ensuring that no one falls through the cracks. Father, make it so at River Hills. I pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Family, friends, I love you, and I miss you. I am so ready for this to be over. But let's not wait to connect, to care, and to serve one another. We can do that today. God bless you. Look forward to seeing you again soon. Have a great day.